Hi all, this is Dr. O, and in this video we're going to start talking about the maxillary artery. We'll focus in on the pterygoid part here, but we'll pick up on other portions of it in future videos. We'll focus here on the major branches that supply the muscles of mastication, the meninges, and the TMJ. So what is that maxillary artery? It is one of the terminal branches of the external carotid artery. We see as external carotid artery courses up in the neck, it gives off its final two. More medial and anterior, we see that maxillary artery. Superficial temporal artery will stay superficial and course superiorly over the temporal fossa and the temporalis muscle. And the maxillary artery has 15 or more branches, depending on where each of the branches comes off. Some can come directly, some off of others, depending on the person. But lots of branches is the big takeaway here. So we're going to break it down into three parts. And we break it down by the lateral pterygoid muscle. So you can see that the lateral pterygoid muscle will divide into a first part, a second part, and a third part. We're going to focus in mostly on the second part here called the pterygoid part, because that's where the branches to the muscles of mastication will come from. Let's take a look in a donor. We'll find the external carotid artery terminates into superficial temporal artery and the maxillary artery. This muscle around this area is the lateral pterygoid muscle. So the portion that we can see most of in this region is the second or the pterygoid part of the maxillary artery. The third part is after the border of the lateral pterygoid muscle, but most of its branches are given off in the pterygopalatine fossa. So you'll talk about that one with Dr. B in the last session. Let's start here with the first part, or the mandibular part of the maxillary artery, and we can see a few branches going to the meninges. So the ordering of branches won't necessarily be constant. There's a lot of variation between different people, and so this is sort of a schematic to show you where things are going, but you want to follow them to know for certain. So we see the first one here is the middle meningeal artery passing up through foramen spinosum to enter into the cranial cavity. There's often an accessory meningeal artery that will course through foramen ovale with V3 and lesser petrosal nerve. In terms of the second part now, this is where we see the muscular branches. So the masseteric artery often we'll see cut because that masseter has to be removed along with the mandible to see these deeper structures. So we see that coming off the second. Also, these anterior deep temporal and posterior deep temporal arteries, you always are going to find the vasculature and neurovasculature to the temporalis muscle coursing superiorly deep to that temporalis muscle. We'll often see a pterygoid branch to the pterygoid muscles coming directly off of the posterior deep temporal artery, but you may see it come from other sources as well. And not labeled here, but what do you think this last branch would be? That's going to be our buccal artery. All right. Then that third part, we see many branches, mostly after the pterygomaxillary fissure, which is what we see represented as a tear shape along here. Let's look at these in a donor. This donor does not have an accessory meningeal artery, so there you go for variation. But we do see a middle meningeal running right up there, the cut masseteric artery, and we see multiple branches to pterygoid muscles. So the pterygoid branches, one coming off of this posterior deep temporal, one coming directly off of the main trunk of the second part. Here we see a nice anterior deep temporal. You'll see these pass deep and superior to get to temporalis muscle. And then again, not labeled, but you can follow this one here, runs right along with this nerve, and that's the buccal artery and the buccal nerve. This is just to show you, because we had removed the auriculotemporal nerve in the last image, I just wanted to remind you of the relationship between auriculotemporal nerve and the middle meningeal artery as it passes toward foramen spinosum. So let's take a look at these branches. There's a lot of it. kind of externally, we find that superficial temporal artery, and running posterior to the mandible is the maxillary artery. And then many of the branches we're seeing here are direct branches of the maxillary artery, going toward, following a lot of these branches we saw of V3 before, going toward the mandible, deep to the mandible, and supplying the muscles in the area. So we'll pick up and talk more about maxillary artery and all of its branches, at least of the first and second part, in the next session. Again, we'll start here by trying to make sure we know the ones that go to the meninges, the TMJ, and the muscles of mastication. All right, so here is our question for this one. So which part of the maxillary artery has branches that parallel the branches from the anterior division of cranial nerve V3, or the mandibular nerve? Is it the first part, the second part, or the third part of maxillary artery? Take a second to think about it. And when you're ready, what did you say? I hear you all saying back to me that you think it is the second part. So the second part of the maxillary artery gives off the same branches as the anterior division of V3. So we'll remember we have a masseteric branch, we have deep temporal branches, pterygoid branches, and then buccal running around here, and that's what we saw here as well. A masseteric branch, pterygoid branches, deep temporal branches, and buccal. So if it helps you to kind of lump those two together in your mind, they're also going to parallel each other to their targets. Now this is everything for this video and for this session. Please feel free to reach out with any questions you may have and enjoy the rest of your day. I'll see you in the next session.